Hello, welcome, welcome to Vermont Law School Annual Dr. Martin Luther King Celebration. Welcome to Vermont Law School. I'd like to welcome our students, faculty, staff, and our guests. Last year, we dedicated our Dr. Martin Luther King program to the late John Lewis, who was a true freedom fighter. This year, I'd like to dedicate our program to Ms. Michelle LaRose, who has been a VLS librarian for 13 years. She is retiring at the end of this month. I dedicate this program to her for her committed service to our students and to our institution. A lot of times I would find Michelle wiping the tears from our students' eyes and giving them a hug with the other arm. We'd like to thank her for her many years here at Vermont Law School. Today, we're here to celebrate Dr. Martin Luther King's birthday. Some celebration in memory of his death, I would like to stress that it's not his death we celebrate, but his life and the things he accomplished, the people he mobilized, and the fight for advocacy that he lit in millions of Americans nationwide. Dr. King started out fighting for the rights of African Americans, not just because he was a member of the race, not because he knew when African Americans were no longer discriminated against, then America could finally live up to being the democratic land of the free that it has claimed to be for so many years. That's why today is a celebration for Dr. King and his nonviolent ways. And I know that we still have a long way to go here in this country, but we must continue to fight for equality, and we must do that in a peaceful manner. As I look back on my life and I think about what I've done to make this a better world, I think about marching with Dr. King and the late John Lewis down in Selma, Alabama. And I remember Bloody Sunday. I could still smell the tear gas, hear the dogs barking, the sound of water hoses, and the people who were hurt that day. As I look around our school and the world today, I see old, young, black, white, straight, gay people to hear today. With every year comes a new generation faced with new obstacles and revised methods of oppression. It is our job to stand up and be accountable. The great Dr. Martin Luther King once said, "At the end, we will remember not the words of our enemy, but the silence of our friends." So as you leave this place today, know that somehow the situation can and will be changed. As you continue your journey, let it be a journey of justice. Let your path be outlined with dignity, discipline, compassion, and most of all, with peace. And along the journey, I hope the sun shines on you with fortitude to help guide the way. And with that in mind, I would like for you, I know you're home. We normally sing the African American anthem, and we would stand out of respect of our ancestors. I ask you today to please stop what you're doing and listen. Ariel King, class of 21, will sing the African American anthem and pay close attention to the second verse. Thank you. Go right ahead, Ariel.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicings rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the presence has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun, let us march on till victory is won. Stony the road we trod, bitter the chastening rod, felt in the day that hope unborn had died. Yet with a steady beat, have not our weary feet come to a place for which our Father sighed. Lest our feet straight to the, come to the places, our God, where we met thee. Lest our hearts drunk with the wine of the world, we forget thee. Out from the gloomy past, till now we stand at last, where the white gleam of our bright star is cast. God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, thou who hast brought us thus far on the way, thou who hast by thy might led us into the light, keep us forever in the path, we pray. We have come over a way that with tears has been watered. We have come treading a path through the blood of the slaughter, shadowed beneath thy hand. May we forever stand true to our God, true to our native land. Thank you.
Ariel, thank you so much. That was lovely. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our celebration today. Thank you so much, Dean Jefferson. You're shortly going to hear from our honored guest, Willie Gary, who will be speaking in a moment. I particularly want to welcome the students from White River Valley Middle School and High School. You should know that every single one of you have the opportunity to become lawyers, and you can even go to law school just up the river from you. Dr. King wrote about many things, but one of the subjects he cared deeply about was education. And he said that the function of education, and I'm quoting him, is to teach one to think intensively and to think critically. Intelligence plus character, that is the goal of true education. And I hope our speaker, Mr. Gary, who's been very active in promoting education, might address that a little bit in his comments. I want to second Dean Jefferson's recognition of the many years of service in our library and to our students by Michelle LaRose. Michelle, thank you very much. It's fitting that we honor you today. It's a special day in our history as Americans, as we mourn the loss and celebrate the accomplishments of the 20th century's best known and most effective advocate for racial equality and nonviolent social change, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. I once had the opportunity to hear Dr. King speak, but so many people headed to Central Park in New York City that day that I'd be exaggerating if I could say anything more than I distantly heard the sound of his voice because so many people were there. But I discovered a link to Dr. King that some of you may find interesting. Earlier this week, while doing some research for today, with a group of my friends, and due to the restrictions of COVID, I decided to try to read the book War and Peace, which, by the way, I recommend to all of you. It's a 1,225 pages long. It has 550 characters, and if you listen to it on tape, it's 55 hours long. It was written by a Russian nobleman named Leo Tolstoy, who wrote it in the 1860s. And later in his life, Tolstoy rejected much of what he wrote in War and Peace, and particularly the episodes in the novel relating to war, as Tolstoy became a proponent of nonviolent resistance. In the late 19th century and early 20th century, Tolstoy corresponded with, and his books and writings were read by, an Indian lawyer named Mahatma Gandhi, who was an anti-colonial nationalist, a political ethicist, and who famously employed nonviolent resistance to lead the successful campaign for India's independence from British rule shortly after World War II. I had the pleasure of reading a book by, which I recommend to all of you, by a guy named Donald Phillips, entitled Martin Luther King on Leadership. And I learned that Dr. King was influenced heavily by Mahatma Gandhi, in turn influenced by Leo Tolstoy, in terms of his commitment to nonviolent resistance. And I just want to share with you very briefly today a couple of the things that Dr. King said and advised about leadership. And I speak to our students at Vermont Law School, those getting JD degrees and master's degrees, because you will be, by virtue of your position and your license to practice law and the policy work you will do, leaders. And Dr. King was a great student of, and of course, a great leader himself. One of my favorite quotes by Dr. King is the following. It's a short one. The quote reads, "A man all wrapped up in himself is a mighty small package." Dean Jefferson, I'm sure you enjoy that one. A man or a woman wrapped all up in himself or herself is a mighty small package. Dr. King believed in leadership by example. He said, and I quote him again, that people are often led to causes and often become committed to great ideas through persons who personify those ideas. And Dr. King was a model for that for me. They have to find the embodiment of the idea in flesh and blood in order to commit themselves to it. And Dr. King famously was a good strategist. And I urge this upon all of you. In his writings on leadership, when he led the bus boycott and later the National Civil Rights Movement, he used the following key strategies. They helped his movement succeed, and at the same time, they secured his leadership position. They may seem obvious, but I think in terms of the social change that we are trying to accomplish in our country in wake of the terrible revelations of racial injustice over the past year, these are good ideas to be thinking about and putting into action. And he recommended five of them. The first was setting goals and creating a plan of action. And that's exactly what Dr. King and his organization did when they created a blueprint for the long-term boycott of the bus system in Montgomery, Alabama. Number two, Dr. King recommended creating a formal alliance. And he set up a new entity, like many of the new entities being set up to address racial injustice across America today. He called it the Montgomery Improvement Association, and they administered the boycott. Number three, Dr. King recommended involving the people. And Mr. Phillips points out in his book that when the first organization of the boycott in Montgomery started, there were only a dozen people that showed up at the meeting that later spread into a national movement. Number four, Dr. King recommended seeking dialogue and negotiation. And I know that's really hard when you care deeply about an issue to seek dialogue and negotiation because you so firmly believe in the correctness of your position. But that was something that Dr. King recommended. And fifth, Dr. King recommended innovation and looking at issues in an innovative and different way. His most famous quote, and the one that so many of you know, but it's worth reminding, is as follows. I have a dream my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. And that really should be the goal of our society. So I'm thrilled to pass the mantle on to the introduction of our speaker. And I'm so happy that you can join us here today in celebrating the immense accomplishments of Dr. Martin Luther King. Thank you.
Thank you and good afternoon. Thank you all for being here. I would like to welcome attorney Rick Irmon, class of 2012, married and father of two young men. With a heart of service, Ricky Irmon, he served at Vermont Law School as a ASP mentor and as a on Black Law Society. Ricky Irmon, he wanted to become an attorney to speak for the voiceless. So please help me welcome attorney Ricky Irmon. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ricky Irmon, as Fido mentioned, and I'm attorney at the law offices of Gary Williams, Parenti, Watson, and Gary in Stuart, Florida. Before I became an attorney, I actually attended and graduated from this very law school about 9 years ago. I was at a conference for aspiring law students in Houston, Texas, and they had a law school fair where representatives from many different schools around the country were in attendance. As I walked by one of the tables, I heard a woman say, "Hey, young man, how you doing?" When I looked over and saw that the woman was standing behind a table that read Vermont Law School, I knew she wasn't talking to me. But then she called me again and said, "Yes, you, come here." She asked me if I ever thought about going to law school in Vermont, and I kindly told her that Vermont's not really in our vocabulary where I'm from. That woman was Dean Shirley Jefferson, and she convinced me to at least apply. I got accepted into several schools, but I ultimately chose Vermont Law. Later on, I actually had the privilege of returning to that same conference as a VLS ambassador and helped Vermont Law recruit other future law students. When I first arrived in South Royalton, Vermont, it was very different than what I was accustomed to say the least. First, I thought, what in the world did I get myself into? Then I thought, okay, I'm gonna get in, do my time, and get out with a degree. But I left with so much more. SoRo actually became my home, and I have fond memories there, believe it or not. Although the winters were brutal, in my opinion, the summer and fall were gorgeous. As far as the campus goes, I remember spending hours at the Chase Center, the library, Barrister's Bookstore, the Academic Success Program Office, Yates, Oaks, Debevoise Hall, and many other places. I also got involved with different organizations on campus and made friends along the way. There are people I met at VLS that I am still very close friends with today. I even remember Dean Jefferson opening up her beautiful home to the students for Thanksgiving, and I remember Professor Latham hosting us at his beautiful home as well. I don't know if this takes place in other law schools, but I truly appreciated and will never forget those moments. Law for the community and the world is the motto that VLS actually practices, and I carry that mission with me now. Vermont Law School welcomed me with open arms, and I'm forever grateful to Dean Jefferson and the VLS staff for believing in me and giving me an opportunity to earn a law degree. Now, I have the pleasure and privilege of introducing someone else who is very special to me. I have never seen an attorney like Willie Gary, and I don't think I ever will again. Besides his oratory gifts, business acumen, and trial skills, Willie Gary is one of my inspirations and one of my heroes. This son of sharecroppers actually had little resources, but extremely large dreams. He was able to work his way out of poverty and start the first African-American law practice in Martin County, Florida. Since no other law firm would hire him, not only did he change his whole family tree financially for generations to come, Willie Gary has given to countless charitable causes, has broken down barriers, and has opened doors for young attorneys of color like me to do the same. Over 40 years ago, no law firm would hire Willie Gary because of his race. Today, Willie Gary's law firm embraces diversity and provides the opportunities that he was once denied. I have admired Mr. G, as we affectionately call him, since I was 16 years old. Here was an attorney who looked like me, showed me that it was possible, and showed me what success looked like. 17 years later, he still continues to impress me. Willie Gary is someone who comes into this world once in a lifetime and makes a lasting impact. Professionally, he has made his mark in legal history numerous times. Personally, he's made his mark on my heart and soul. My firstborn son was 6 months old when I first came to work for Mr. Gary. And I'm forever grateful for the opportunity he's given me to feed my family. This has really come full circle for me. Thank you so much for your time. I'm truly humbled and honored to be back at Vermont Law School, albeit virtually, to introduce my mentor, partner, and boss, the legendary Willie Gary. Before Mr. Gary speaks, we will show a short video now. Thank you again.
The law firm of Gary Williams, Parenti, Watson, and Gary would like to welcome each and every one of you. Willie E. Gary is a living legend and a proud graduate of Shaw University and North Carolina Central University's School of Law. Attorney Willie Gary is celebrated as one of the most famous lawyers in the nation and recently won a record-breaking $23.6 billion verdict in a single tobacco suit filed against R.J. Reynolds Tobacco Company. Celebrated as the largest single verdict in U.S. history, this case was covered on all major networks in the United States, including Fox News, The Today Show, CNBC, CNN, NBC, Headline News, and many other news outlets, both nationally and internationally.
The nation's second largest cigarette maker is fighting this morning to reduce a $23 billion jury award. The plaintiff, the widow of a smoker, it is among the biggest verdicts ever for a single plaintiff in a wrongful death lawsuit.
The six jurors decided that tobacco company R.J. Reynolds should pay Robinson $17 million in compensatory damages and $23.6 billion in punitive damages for the death of her husband, Michael Johnson. He died of lung cancer in 1996.
Now to a Today Show exclusive. The widow of a chain smoker who died of lung cancer in 1996 is awarded more than $23 billion in punitive damages against the nation's second largest cigarette maker, R.J. Reynolds. And yes, you heard me right, $23 billion.
A Florida jury has returned one of the largest verdicts ever against a tobacco company. Cynthia Robertson sued R.J. Reynolds because her husband had died of lung cancer after a lifetime of smoking. She will be awarded more than $16 million in compensatory damages and, wait for it, $23 billion in punitive damages. Her attorney, Willie Gary, is here with us in the studio. So, welcome to the program.
Good to be here. It's not about the appeals. It's not about the money. We've made a difference already. I think less people are going to smoke. I think that the tobacco companies are going to get their act together. They're going to make safer cigarettes. We know they can. They'll just make a little bit less money, but we'll save a whole lot of lives. And that's what it's all about.
Gary added the lawsuit's goal was to stop tobacco companies from targeting children and young people with their advertising.
News 4 has learned new details of one of the largest jury verdicts ever.
That's right, we're talking about $23 billion awarded overnight to a Florida family.
From rags to riches, Willie E. Gary is a true American success story. His unwavering desire to earn a college education ultimately led him from migrant worker to Shaw University and eventually to North Carolina Central University's School of Law. Yes, historically black colleges and universities definitely produce winners. Now, ladies and gentlemen, are you ready? Are you ready to meet our speaker for today? A gentleman whose humble beginnings as a migrant worker took him from Florida to the Carolinas and eventually back to Florida, where he would create one of the most influential law firms in this country. Attorney Willie E. Gary firmly believes that it is only but by the grace of God that he has achieved multi-million dollar successes. He also understands that were it not for the many trailblazers who preceded him, he would not be where he is today. His commitment to excellence is reflected not only in his many professional accomplishments, but also in his commitment to family, community, and social change. Honored as one of Florida's first black lawyers, Willie E. Gary is a philanthropist who has given so much to so many.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, please allow Willie Gary to share with you his secret to success.
You know, I just think that when you have God on your side, you can do anything.
If I had God for the Lord, I don't know where. Let me tell the truth tonight.
Now, if you had
testify tonight, y'all, for the Lord on my side, don't know where I would be, y'all.
Good evening. It's good to be here. It's good to be at the law school that produced this young man that is, Ricky is, Armand is just, he's amazing. He's making a difference. And I'm glad that we had the opportunity to be a part of that, and because it all started at Vermont Law School. So I know this is a, the whole approach to just doing the communications by way of computer is kind of different, but at any rate, we're gonna rock the joint. We're gonna have a good time. We have some high school students here. We have some middle school students here. And thanks to Dean Jefferson, thank you for being so committed to community service and making a difference in the lives of young boys and girls, men and women who are seeking to become lawyers. Ricky, I enjoyed those comments that you made. As a matter of fact, when you started talking, and boy, it started to get good to me. Just as you about to stop, I wanted to say, Ricky, keep on talking. And Theo, thank you for being one of our best students that we've had to come through here. Some good things waiting ahead for you. You put the time in, you're dedicated, and when you do that, it really makes a difference. Now, I'm excited about being here. I really am. I'm excited because I had the opportunity to meet your Dean, Dean Jefferson, Associate Dean Jefferson, in New York. I think it was last year, Ricky. And she's just impressive. You know, you can tell she's into what she's doing. She's dedicated to helping, and I'm sure it's not just law students, but we have some middle schoolers here today, I understand, as well as some high school students as well. So I know she is committed to young people being the best that they can be. And this is a big day today. This is the day following the death of one of our most prolific preachers, leaders, writers, you name it, this country has ever known, as Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. So when I got the opportunity, I didn't hesitate to accept it. And Ricky pulled me aside and said, look, let's do it. If it's for Dr. King and celebrating the life that he lived and what he gave to this country and the world so that his people would have a better place to live. And students, law students, I want to just challenge you, and I want to challenge not just the law students, but all of us, to never catch amnesia. That's why every time his birthday rolls, and not only when his birthday rolls around, but you should celebrate and appreciate Dr. King every day that you get a chance to wake up. He played a part in making that happen. So don't ever forget that. Dr. King is smiling on you. He's looking down, he's smiling on you. And I know that he's proud of the law students and the high schoolers and the middle schoolers. Work with me here, because I'm going to cover all the bases today. We're going to get high school, we're going to get middle school, and we're going to get some young men and women that getting ready to go out and become lawyers. Become lawyers. Young people, study hard. Study hard. And don't let anybody tell you that you can't be whatever it is that you want to be. And even if you haven't decided on what you want to be, just know that it's there for you. All it takes from you is dig deep now while you're in middle school, while you're in high school. You know, make it happen. Make the best grades that you can make. Study as hard as you can study. And don't let anybody even remotely tell you that you can't be, whether it's a doctor, whether it's a lawyer, politician, professor, Whatever it is that you want to be, young people, you can do it. Dr. King gave his life, helped pave the way for you to have the opportunity to be all that you can be. And you don't have the right, young people, to let him down. You don't have, you are indebted to Dr. King, and not only Dr. King, but those black and white that marched from Selma to Montgomery, Alabama. We're celebrating his birthday, but you need to know he was amazing. He was a leader beyond leaders. Those who marched on Bloody Sunday was marching for you, young people, to have the opportunity, just have the right to vote, and to have the right to be in a position to go to college, get an education. He died. He died. Fighting for you to have that. And you don't have the right to let him down. So I challenge the young people, those in middle school, those in high school, I challenge you. I challenge you to dream big dreams and think about what he gave up to have, so that you would have the opportunity to be all that you could be. And then law students, I challenge you. I challenge you because you're in a position to be challenged. You must blaze new trails, pioneer new paths, and don't let anybody tell you that you can't be the best, because you can. But I want to challenge you, young law students, when you make it, and I know you will. Oh, yes, I see success written all over the place. But when you make it, don't you catch amnesia. You know, a lot of us making it, no sooner than we make it, we hang on our do not disturb sign, put on our shades of indifference, and have the nerve to think that we got to where we are on our own. But doubtless to say, our old silver-headed grandmothers had more sense on accident than most of us have on purpose. You didn't get to where you are on your own. So don't ever, ever forget that there's a debt that's outstanding. And I know you're gonna make up. You're gonna pay up by being good lawyers and good judges and things of that nature. And then I want to say, I have to always do this. I know we're at the great law school here in Vermont, the School of Law here. But I don't want to be marketing for historically black colleges on your turf. But I just gotta tell these young people. You know, give black colleges a chance. Give them a chance. I was born one of 11 children, the sharecroppers. Went to school a half a day, no shoes on my feet. Went barefooted, but I had to go. Mom and daddy were sheep. They worked from sunup to sundown. My daddy had a second grade education. My mom had a ninth grade education, but she gave birth to my sister on a Friday and she was back in the cotton fields working on a Monday. Don't tell me you can't be what you want to be. You can do it. I know you can. And let me tell you something else. Nobody's going to give you anything. There are no free rides. Let me just tell you, there are no free rides. You're going to have to make it happen, but you can. Make it up in your mind now that you're going to be a lawyer, judge, or whatever. But if not a lawyer, judge, whatever the case may be, the sky is the limit. And let me say this, after you make it, and I know you're going to make it, there's no doubt in my mind about that. Law students, you're going to go out there, you're going to do great things. You're going to make Thurgood Marshall proud, Dr. King proud. You're going to do it. But when you make it, just remember that there are those who are less fortunate than you are, and you don't have the right not to reach back and pull them along the way. Reach back, because you know, some of us, when we make it, we got to understand that, you know, but for God being in the plan, but for God being on your side, the ultimate, and you working hard and you doing all that you can do, you would be where you are. So I want to just close by saying that you know, in all that you do, and I know that you're going to do a lot, you're going to do major great things, but in all that you do, after you make the money and do all of that, keep God in your hand for your plans. Keep God in your plans, because if you do, I guarantee you that the roads will always rise to meet you. The wind will always be at your backs, and the sun will shine warmly upon your faces, young people. And the rain will fall softly upon your fields till we meet again next year, Vermont. Remember, God will take care of you. Thank you, and may God bless you.
Thank you so much.
Are there any questions? I guess Associate Dean Jefferson would direct them, but I'm here to answer any questions and say any other words that may inspire you.
Yes, Attorney Gary, Ariel will send us some questions, but I had a question for you. I know when you finished law school and you tried to get a job with a lot of the firms and you were turned down because you were Black. What gave you the strength to continue on and not give up?
Well, it's about, I had an attitude, Dean Jefferson. I had a strong attitude about being somebody. And when I got out of Shaw University, a historically Black college, NCCU Law School, a historically Black law school, I said, you know, one day I'm going to be a lawyer. I felt it. But times were tough. When I came back to South Florida, here in Stuart, Florida is a little town on the coast, and a lot of people come here for vacationing, and a lot of wealthy people. And I started thinking maybe I'm out of my league. I need to go somewhere else because the competition is perfect. But it dawned on me, you know, you can outwork anybody. Now, and so I said just a few months ago, I was speaking to some young students about Black colleges. I do want to finish that. You know, I was told I wasn't good enough by all the other schools, and Black colleges gave me a chance. So, you know, I have to plug Black colleges. And of course, but get an education, young people, those in middle school and high school, stick with it, make it happen, dream big, and don't let in lawyers, doctors, dentists, educators, whatever the case may be. Just be somebody. So I was here in Stuart, first Black lawyer to ever set foot in Stuart, Florida, in the whole county. Didn't know anybody because I had been away for a while. But even with all of that, young people, I was dreaming big dreams. But I tell you what, that second grade education my dad had, it taught me to don't let anybody outwork you. Nobody. Young people, I challenge you. And Dean, that's how it all started. I just, in the cotton fields, wanted my daddy, when he planted his crops, he fussed about having the best. He wanted his potatoes to have more potatoes on the vines than anybody else. So it's all about an attitude, really.
You know, Attorney Gary, you know, Vermont is a predominantly white state. And you encouraging to apply to historically Black colleges. Should some of these high schoolers apply to a historically Black college, and why?
They should, because like I said, they were there when we had no place to go. Historically Black colleges were there. Go to Vermont, go wherever you want to go, wherever you feel good about you know, the surroundings, and sometimes people come to Miami, University of Miami, because of the beach. Well, you whatever it is that you're thinking, and if it gets you in college, in at some university somewhere, young people, that's what it's all about. You got to go to school. You have to go to school. There's no excuse for not going to school. But, you know, sometimes you got to, you know, mix it up. I know a lot of good people that worked for 10, 15 years and went back to school. And so as long as you got your mind set that you're going to do something, you know, you're going to, it's okay. But I strongly support historically black colleges. And, hey.
You know, I think that's a good idea.
I do too.
Attorney Gary, I think that one of the things, and I teach a course here at the law school called Race in the Law, and I believe that one of the way, and we're in a fix right now, is that we all have to get to know each other. I think that if some white students here attend a historic black college, they will get to know black students, and the black students will get to know them. It's almost like the law school here. We have to step out of our comfort zone. And I want to say that today, what's going on in this country, you know, the uproar, the violence, and the uprising. What do you have to say about it? What do you have to say about it? Do you have anything to say about it, or maybe you don't?
I'm sorry, I was waiting for you and you had finished. I'm sorry. We are living in some tough times. There's no doubt about it, but I'm convinced that tough times don't last, but tough people do. So we got to dig in. It's shaky. I mean, the whole garment is rocking and reeling. You know, you don't know where the next, you know, a lot of people don't know where the next meal is going to come from. It's down deep, down low. But we got to rise above it. We got to reach out and turn to our brothers and sisters who are less fortunate than we are, give back, help them out, do whatever the case may be. I mean, we do it here in our law firm. This past Christmas, we probably served more dinners at one of our daycare centers than you would even dream or think we would take place. But you just gotta, don't catch amnesia. If there was ever a time that our people needed us to reach back and give back and not forget, that time is now. We're looking at some tough times. I won't get into the politics of it, but you know, we gotta dig deep. We gotta dig down deep and rise above it, because it's tough times in America. But somewhere somebody said, "Tough times don't last. Tough people do." Let's give that young lady a hand. That beautiful song. Give her a hand. Give her a hand. Thank you. Thank you, young lady. Good job.
And Ariel has some questions for you. Yeah.
I'll go right ahead.
Yes. I'm going to read off some of the questions that we've received from the chat. And I want to encourage other people that if they want to send questions to Attorney Gary, please do so by using the chat function on our live stream page. So the first question that I have is, when Martin Luther King was killed, over half of the American population did not like him for one reason or another. What are your thoughts on sticking to your purpose, even if it isn't popular?
Well, obviously, his purpose was not popular. As a matter of fact, it was his purpose that caused him to lose his life. But at some point in life, man, woman, boy, girl, no matter who you are, you got to stand for something or you'll fall for anything. And he stood for something. He fought for something. And I encourage all of us, maybe in a different way, different time, different style, but we got to fight for something. You know, you got to be about more than just you and what's good for you. You got to make a difference for those that are less fortunate. And that sometimes we get so busy following our own dreams. You know, creating our own driving patterns of whatever force us to get more money, to build a bigger house or find a car. No, you and don't get me wrong, I love my ride. I'm not giving up my ride. Nah, just kidding. I'd give it up in a minute if it made a difference to that extent. But somebody died for me. So at some point, you got to be really, really ready to fight for someone else. And those times are approaching us in America. You don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. But we're in this together, both black and white. Nobody can make it. We can't separate. We can't get our people and make a difference. We're going to do this together. We're going to be all that we can be for each other. And maybe this is God's way of just bringing us closer together. I'm ready to fight for my brothers and sisters, and the color of their skin doesn't matter. We're in this together. When I say fight, I'm talking about, you know, helping each other, reaching out to each other. Don't ever look down on anybody unless you're picking them up. You gotta help somebody.
Thank you so much for that answer. The next question is, given everything that's happening, what provides you with a sense of comfort right now?
Well, it's my faith. I just believe that, you know, I believe in my faith. I believe that God is in the plans, but you got to take it and you got to run with it. You got to make it happen. You know, you got to refuse to quit, refuse to give up. Because if you keep living, you're going to face some tough obstacles in life. And sometimes you it appears that you may not make it, but don't give up. Don't give up. Dr. King didn't give up. And those who followed him didn't give up. So it's about an attitude, develop an attitude. You know, you have that professor that you know is not giving you a fair shake. Whether maybe you got to study 10 hours rather than 5 hours. To make a difference, because you know you're gonna. So make it happen.
Thank you.
Next question.
The next question is, how do we grow even stronger as a community to successfully fight against the white supremacy that has been unleashed and encouraged within our nation?
Well, the white community and the black community, you know, without a doubt, is going to turn things around. And that's the only way I see it. You know, we're brothers and we're sisters. We're in this, like I said before, in this fight together. And going in different directions is going nowhere. So we're going to have to tune up our motors and drive in the same direction. And you know, what impressed me so much about Black Lives Matter, there were just as many white people involved as there were black people. That's a good sign, because, you know, we're in this together. And you got some mean people out there, people that hate you for no reason, just because of the color of your skin. You've done nothing. You know, so, but you have, thank God, you have black people, white people, Hispanics and others, man, marching together, taking that, whatever they had to do, they did it together. And I noticed this over the last few months, and I'm telling you, it makes me feel good about our chances of being all that we can be as a nation, because we've come up short. But you know, we just got to rise above it and make it happen anyway.
Thank you. The next question is, are you inspired by any particular or specific activist today?
Well, I like a young man that, I wouldn't even single any one person out. I like the Black Lives Matter movement. I think it's given black people, white people, Hispanic people a chance to come together. So if there was any, I wouldn't say one person, I'd say the movement. And right now, like when Dr. King and all those marched from Selma to Montgomery, when they marched on Washington, the only thing I like about Dr. King's march, they had black and white together. But it was a people's march. It was a peaceful march. And unlike some others that we know of, we just got to hang in there and work towards making America all that it can be for all of us, regardless of your skin color or your nationality, or whatever the case may be.
Thank you. So you've talked a lot about how important working hard is, and just as important as working hard is resting. So what are some things that you do to rest and make sure that you're replenished so that you can sustain working hard and keep continuing to fight?
Yeah, you got to take care of yourself. You know, I'm 73 years old, and still I try to get on the treadmill, try to eat the right foods. It takes work at anything that you're doing, even if you're raising your children, even if you know. My wife and I met in the second grade. We met in the second grade. And you have to work at it, because you're going to have some ups and you have some downs. You have some times that you don't feel good, times that you do, times that you're happy, times that you're not happy. We met in the second grade, and she used to hate the sound of my name. And Dean Jefferson, every time she'd hear the name Willie Gary, she would just cry.
Oh, no.
Didn't want me anywhere in sight. And I knew she was digging on me, you understand? But I thank God every day that he saw fit to keep us together. And I know that I'm a little jackleg lawyer, and people think that, well, Willie's this, Willie's that. But I'm here to tell you that no matter what anybody else thinks, I know that but for her, you know, I wouldn't be where I am today. So y'all give Gloria Gary a big hand. Give her a big hand. Dean Jefferson.
Behind it is a strong woman. I will agree to that.
Yes.
Right. You know, I know Ernie, I probably got a couple of more questions to ask you, but I got a question that I want to ask you, and I know it's burning in everybody else's mind too. Now, here you are, a black man lawyer, getting these $2.3 billion settlement. How did that set with the white?
You know,
And how did that sit with the other white lawyers down there in Florida?
Well, you know, in Florida, just like any other place, you have good people, you have bad people. You in Florida, you have a lot of people, you know. I gotta say, I came to Stuart, there were no black lawyers at all. And I couldn't get a job, but I had Shields McManus, who later became a judge. He was a law partner of mine. I'm in an all-white county, just about. Maybe 2% black, if you're lucky. So, but times were tough, but there were some white lawyers that reached out to me. And I'll never forget that, because I was the only black lawyer in the whole county. I didn't know anybody. And let me tell you, there were some tough, diehard, racist lawyers as well. I offered to work for nothing, young people, and they still wouldn't give me a job. I just wanted to work. I wanted to learn. That's why I say, but I didn't give up. I didn't quit. And I didn't give out, because I wanted to be a lawyer and not just an ordinary lawyer. And, you know, God has blessed me that I've been able, along with some other good people working together, because you're always in it with someone. You're never by yourself. You can't do it. No matter, Dean Jefferson, no matter how good a lawyer you are, you're going to need somebody to help you carry the load. And I'm happy and excited about, you know, the young lawyers that we have here at the firm who are really, really making a difference.
Attorney Gary, you know my mentor, and I think you remember her, Mike Noel. She's dead now, Wilhelmina Rolock and Kevin Rolock in Washington, D.C.
Boy, the Rolock name, it rings a bell. It surely rings
United Black Fund. United Black Fund. I first met you when I was with her at a National Bar Association conference.
Right.
In Philly, but the Rolocks. And you're right. These young lawyers are going to need someone. And the reason why I was so determined to get you to come here today, for a couple of reasons. I was selfish, as usual. I wanted our students to see a positive side of us. I wanted them to see, and especially the high school and the middle school, and my granddaughter who goes to, you know, the White River Valley High School, Leah Fitz Turkvan. I'm turning on her now. I wanted them to see a black man in a positive way, making money in this country and knowing that this country might be going through something now and that we once were slaves, but you can make it in this country. You can make it. And I wanted the white students to see that if you could make it and you challenged them to be the best that they could be, that they could see that if a black man can make it in this country, they can too. That's and right. I just thought that this would be a good time, you know, to showcase some of the things that Dr. King died for. I can remember seeing Dr. King at Tabernacle Baptist Church in Selma. And he talked about nonviolence, and he talked about this country, how much he loved it. And he said that we were promised a lot of things in this country. And one of the things he said was that we were going to be treated equally and that we could make it. And at that time, he said when he tried to cash that check, that America had given us a check. And when he tried to cash it, it was insufficient funds. And I believe in my heart, and this is what I say to you, I'm gonna let you take it away. I believe within my heart that we're getting closer to getting that check cashed through it all, what we're going through. What do you think?
Absolutely. I think we are, because, you know, when you're really thinking about it, we've made a lot of, we're not where we want to be, but thank God we're a long, long way from where we used to be.
Yes.
Long from where we used to be. This hotel where our office is, and we get Ricky and Charles here, and Diane, who's my boss, she's here. Kevin, who's our tech, who's white, Diane is white, Ricky, Charles, and myself, we're black. You know, people are coming together, because I remember this building being a hotel, an old hotel for rich white people, sitting on the banks of the St. Lucie River. And I got a job here in 11th grade as a dishwasher, scrubbing floors. And that's why I'm here to tell you, young people, don't let anybody tell you that you can't be somebody. You can be whatever you want. And I got a job here scrubbing floors. I was proud of it. But so nobody's going to stop us. We're making progress every day. I mean, it's going to happen. It's in the blood. We just got to keep it going. And I never forget, you got to be careful how you treat people. Because what goes around
comes around. Comes around.
So be careful. Don't ever look down on anybody.
Yeah, we might have time for one more question. And we do, okay.
Okay, so our final question reads, upon reflection, what would 2021 Willie Gary tell 1L Willie Gary regarding the importance of civil procedure? And I'm going to extend that question a little bit and just ask, what would you tell 1L, the 1L version of yourself right now about law school, what to focus on, things of that nature?
Develop a never give up attitude. Never give up, not just law school, not just law classes or whatever, but it's about an attitude. Because I know for a fact that the deck was stacked against me and I wasn't supposed to make it. But I didn't quit. You know, I knew when I decided I had a job, Charles and Ricky, I had a job, my own business, cutting lawns. But I had more work than any lawn cutter in town. And I decided the last minute I was, man, getting my application together, I'm going to law school. That's why when people tell you you can't do it, you gotta dig down deep in your heart and believe that you're going to overcome. I got in law school on a wing and a prayer. You know, a wing and a prayer. I mean, filed late, did everything, had my own business, and I realized I wanted to go up, take it up a notch. I wanted to be a lawyer. I had always wanted to be a lawyer anyway, so I got my chance, My 1Ls, it's gonna get a little bit lighter for you, but that first year, man, you got to get down and dig deep and burn the midnight oil and, you know, just make it happen. And that's what I did, because, you know, nobody, you know, all of my friends, but man, you crazy, you just can't decide to go to law school. And I talked my way into law school. My mama told me then, said, boy, you should be a good lawyer. But young people, don't give up. Don't give out. Study hard. Don't let anybody outwork you. I guarantee you, nobody's going to work any harder than you once you make it up your mind. And it makes a difference. When we took on the big corporations, the major corporations, you know, we outworked them. Because I never forget it. Sometimes in the hotels, I see them going to bed around 9 o'clock. Our lawyers had to work all night, but we did it.
Right. Oh, yes, yes.
We did it. I had Charles, we went to Alabama. What city was that, Charles? Gaskin, Alabama. And he was working to 3 and 4 o'clock in the morning, and he'd work 4 o'clock and decide that he wanted to just go down to his room for a second. He said, I'm going down to my room, Mr. Gary. I say, for what? You know, I say, man, you got to go. But young people work hard. That's why I had an attitude about outworking people. Outworking people. Thank you for having me.
Well, thank you for keeping your promise. You told me you're going to come, and you're going to come back in real time. And I just want to say something about this little old law school, with the only law school in the country without a red light, compost toilet, and stain on our carpet, gave me an opportunity when no one else would. And that's what we continue to do today. And I want to thank you for coming and encouraging our students and encouraging me, too. Because I get down and need encouragement. Good. And I thank
you. I want to thank Ricky.
Yes.
I mean, he was in my face every day until he got this all put together. He put it all together. And so I want to thank you, Ricky.
Well, he knew how important it was, and don't you forget Fido. Fido was in your family.
Fido is really the one behind Ricky that made it all.
Ricky was
Fido was making it all happen. He was the one that was getting it done. So thank you.
I know. And Fido worked in your law firm before coming to law school, and last summer he worked at your law firm again. And I'd just like to thank Ariel for singing, our Dean, President Thomas McHenry, for speaking, Teresa Johnson, Sarah Galen, who's like the moderator, she's pulling out those questions for us, Karen Henderson, Angie Campbell, your folks, Corey, Kevin, and Emily Potts, and Angie Campbell, and Justin Campfield, and I'd like to thank Mr. McCracken for bringing the high school kids here and the middle school principal, and just like to thank the whole VLS community. And with that in mind, I'd like for Ariel to sing, you know we have to sing, We Shall Overcome. And again, if you're with someone, we normally would stand and cross hands. If you are with someone, grab their hands and shake and sing with Ariel. And Attorney Gary, this won't be our last time seeing each other. From the bottom of my heart and with great appreciation.
Thank you too. Thank you so much for being who you are and being as committed to these young people, these young lawyers and lawyers to be. It's people like you that are inspiring them. I mean, you should hear some of the good stories that Ricky tells about you, and it's amazing that you just never caught amnesia. You know, like some of us, well, we make it and we can't.
Well, I've never get amnesia, never. Thank you. Okay, Ariel, you ready?
I'm ready.
All right.
Okay. We shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome someday. Oh, dear.
We shall overcome someday. We shall live in peace. We shall live in peace. We shall live in peace someday. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe that we shall overcome someday. We are not afraid. We are not afraid. We are not afraid to that we shall overcome someday. We shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome someday. Shall overcome someday.
Thank you, everyone.